This is a combination of my 25 years of military life and military thinking and 15 years in the corporate world, of which last 10 years have been as good as a startup. And I have seen bankruptcies so many times, but there was only one determination in my mind that if we do, we'll do it right. And today when we talk, the series is a result of that. Shubhankar had joined me as an intern. He did about 4 or 5 internships with me. Thereafter, he completed his graduation and he joined an MNC. He left that job in the MNC and joined my company, taking the first baby step into entrepreneurship, into thinking, into the entire process that I have been following. And today here he is with me with his first hand experience, on job experience, where there is no job, from picking up of boxes to sourcing to touring to business development to attending meetings, meeting the director generals of police, entire spectrum Shubhankar handles independently. So here we are. As far as the first 9 episodes were concerned, Shubhankar, I think we basically focused on the sequential way of doing work.
Yes, actually it was 8 episodes, and we've basically covered the most basic thing that an entrepreneur should know, which is thinking, and how do you think, and what are the main sort of frameworks that we have developed that we use in our company to think on a daily basis. And we've covered the art of thinking from macro to micro, and then going back from the micro to macro, and then just doing that constant shuttling from these two states. We've also covered sequential, simultaneous thinking. We've covered thinking on a timeline, how sequential and simultaneous thinking combines on a timeline. We've also spoken about out-of-the-box thinking. So all of these things combined has been the meat of our content for the last few episodes. Over the next few episodes, we want to convert all of these into case studies, into actionable stories that you will understand, and maybe glean some more insights out of.
See, the as far as the thinking part is concerned, 6 specific topics: sequential thinking, simultaneous thinking, that is sequentiality, simultaneity, macro, micro, out of the box, and everything put on a timeline. Now, what are these 6, and how exactly do they help us, and where do they help us? Is it to do with entrepreneurship? No, this is to do with life. You will say, what is so different about that? I'll tell you what is so different about it. Military is field, operations is field. You don't have laptops, you don't have internet, you don't have mobile, you don't have books, you don't have anything. There is only one thing with you, that is mind, and you are in real time operations. There is no second chance. So over a period of time, I developed my own theory as to how do I handle 200 issues going on simultaneously, which may be on one hand fighting a battle on the LOC, to the other hand giving a ring at 4:35 in the morning to a father to tell that his son is no more. How do I handle the ammunition? How do I handle men? And how do I handle the weather, high altitude? So there is not one. There are millions of things, and there is only one thing to assist, that is your mind. So I trained my mind in such a way that at any real time, if you take a slice of time, if there are 100 things that I was supposed to do, I would have addressed each of these 100. So over a period of time, I developed my own theory of sequentiality, simultaneity, macro, micro, out of the box. This incidentally is a word I hate. I always ask only one question: who the hell put you there first? Or why did you go in a box first? So I was never in a box. So there is nothing called out of box thinking for me. I think independently. And last is, all of these things, how do you put it on a time scale? On a timeline? This simply means only one thing. To be a successful human being, to be a successful man, to be a successful father, to be a successful husband, to be a successful boyfriend, to be a successful entrepreneur, to be a successful vice president.
To be a successful wife, girlfriend, we are not sexist. It's all of those.
Everyone. So how exactly do you handle everything? It's what this series is all about. So I am here to tell you my experience. Shubhankar is the one who has actually undergone this entire thing himself over the last 3 years. He has his own experiences. I have had mine. I have had all the smiles in the last 3 years. Shubhankar has had none. And so which,
yeah, that's very true.
Actually a fact. But then that's how you learn. But then Shubhankar is here to share his story. I am here to share mine. So what we plan to do now, over the next about, like Shubhankar said, this is the 9th episode.
This is the
9th. We had finished 8th. By mistake, I said earlier 9. So this is the 9th episode. From here, what we will do is, we are thinking about 4 or 5 case studies. And these are not typical case studies. These are the actual happenings of events which have taken place. And despite, when I say word despite, it is in bold and capital, that despite so many things, how could we actually, week to week, day to day, hour to hour, survive whatever we did? And this actually, thereafter, when we sit and look in hindsight, these actually are case studies.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely.
How we plan to do is, the first one is going to be about our company. So I would be doing most of the talking, where Shubhankar was there for part, and he was not there for part of it. The second one and the third one is going to be actually the consulting part that we did, where we have actually gone to companies and we have seen. So this is so that the entrepreneurs also learn out of this. The next two are going to be the personal experiences of Shubhankar, where how he has applied all this thinking into his real life. And how did he have this work-life balance? When I see people talking about how stressed they are in corporate and how stressful corporate is, I have my reservations. No, they don't know how to think, how to plan. There is nothing stressful if you do it correctly. Macro to micro is everything about knowing everything in the bigger picture, at the same time knowing how exactly the smallest of each of the component, which when combined becomes macro, functions. So I must know at the lowest level every process. At the same time, I must know the highest.
Yeah.
The problem today with people is what? As far as an entrepreneur is concerned, he assumes he knows everything. He wants to do everything himself. And when things start going wrong, he starts blaming someone else.
Yeah.
That's a problem. He is not ready to accept first that he does not know. He hesitates to learn. And thereafter, when things start going wrong, he starts blaming someone else.
Yeah. That's a very good point, sir. Actually, when I was thinking about this, that we always, in popular culture at least, we always encourage young people to follow your dreams, believe in yourself, believe in your own capabilities. But the thing that no one says is that you need to have developed your capabilities before you form a belief in them.
Absolutely.
So it's very important for any entrepreneur, not just a young person, to first audit themselves. If they have real skills that are required for entrepreneurship. Now, for someone who's just starting out, the first question he or she will ask is that, how do I know what skills are required? That's what we are putting out these videos for. What we simply hope from these videos is that you get a good idea of the things that you must do to be able to be a good entrepreneur, to be able to be a successful entrepreneur. And if you see yourself falling short in any of these things, then you already have your answer. You need to form these skills first, preferably in an environment that you know, maybe allows you to be closer to an entrepreneur while you're still doing a job, like how the model that I try to follow with Colonel Pandey, rather than just going into entrepreneurship all at once and becoming just another statistic in that 99%
of failures. Yeah.
99% of failures.
I'll start this particular episode. So when I talk about case study, I'll talk about case study of my own company and my own life. So it's my personal life and the company. As far as I'm concerned, both are same. I am made of my company and my company is made up of me. So I'll just cover the last 3 years, where 4 years maybe, probably the lowest dip. We couldn't have gone lower than that in every aspect. Personally, my 30 years of married life came to an end in the last quarter of 2017. When my wife passed away. Before that, for 3 years, I was completely focused on treating her cancer treatment. So company was left to people who always told me that, yes, we are doing our best. Sales are taken care of. Finances taken care of. Administration taken care of. HR taken care of. Marketing taken care of. Business development there. And I would take my reviews, but I could never focus. The day I attended the funeral of my wife. The next day morning, I went to my office alone, opened, closed it and sat there for 3 hours. And that's the time I started thinking about everything. I came to macro. Where exactly am I? Where exactly is my company? Where exactly is my life? Where exactly is my son? Where exactly is my daughter? What happens if I close the company? How many employees are there? What happens to them? So this is that absolute big macro. And I knew each and every employee, each and every work, each and every opportunity which was going on, but someone else was doing it. I had no choice but to watch for some time. And in 2 months, I gave an option to the people to give it to me in writing that they would resign from the company if the company has to close or they may leave on their own. The first warning was given in February 2018. And I started giving 3 months to everyone to perform or perish. I had already decided to give 1 year of performance time to them and thereafter take decisions. So 31st March when it came, there were practically no sales. And all the promises that we have done, we have been doing when you have been away, when you have been treating your wife and this, that. So that's the first time, not that I did not know, but that is the first time it actually got proven that there is nothing called empathy, there is nothing called pity, there is nothing called anything as far as the employees are concerned or someone who is working in your company towards you. So they want their salary on a given date and they thereafter, they just have to give reports. The advantage with me was that this company from the scratch was raised by me, from sales to marketing to BD to HR to licensing to the processes, to each and every HR process, every document, every standing operating procedure. There is nothing making of forms and there is practically nothing in this company which I have not made with my own hands. So as far as I was concerned, I was very, very comfortable. And there's something I always would say. This company will not die. It will run even if it is with one man, that is me. There's no question this company will ever close, but I am not very sure whether you are going to be there that time or not. So you cannot be actually passengers. You have to work. And they would not. And then finally, it came down to, okay, yeah, well, I'm getting a 50 lakh sale, and the sale will come in the first week of March, and the 80 lakh sale, and it'll come in the first week of March, and it'll come in the third week of March, fine. So on exactly 30 days before the deadline of March, the marching orders were given to people, open marching orders, that soon as your orders come, so you take yourself, you are on the job. Else you take these as the marching orders. And then it was 1 year back that they had been warned, and that every 3 months it was happening. It was in this, the two later quarters of that financial year, 18, that Shubhankar joined. And when he joined, he was very, very clearly told that, okay, I'll sustain you for 1 year. But thereafter, if the company doesn't perform, even you go. But I could not have blamed Shubhankar at all. He had come to me with a full belief to learn. He never came with promises that I will do this for you. So imagine my state where my son had to be sent abroad for studies and we had no money. I had to do that. I was undergoing a personal loss.
He went, I think, maybe a month or so before I joined.
Yeah, in so October. That was the previous, 1 year previous to him. So when I was running the company alone, and then I, the clients, the telephone, so the contacts, 90% of the clients did not exist. The contact numbers did not respond. And I have been in this game for a long, long time. I always knew how to revive the business. But then I had to test people. I tested my people. I finally found, and they were all given marching orders. And then that is the time Shubhankar, when he joined, so probably I also wanted to give him a feel of independence. So he was given such independence in sales marketing that you can't imagine. There were no restrictions on him. Money, travel, clients, where the clients were, how to go about, all this initial briefing, initial training, everything given. Thereafter, it was legwork. It's Shubhankar who will tell you later, or I think he's already told you in one of the episodes.
Yeah, one of the earlier episodes.
The type of traveling that he has done.
Yeah.
But then I didn't expect sales from him. And by March of 2019, anyone who had to be relieved, they were relieved. So it was only me left. Shubhankar joined. And Shubhankar was a rookie. He was learning. I had given him a promise that I will teach you each and every rope of entrepreneurship. And unless you do it, unless you slog, unless you sweat, unless you bleed, you will never learn. It is not theoretical.
Yeah.
And what I liked about Shubhankar was that unlike the entrepreneurs that we always see, that one degree, one idea, one prototype, and thereafter the man gives himself that he knows everything. And 99% startups fail. Why does it happen? There are companies which are running with massive revenue, which have a potential of multiplying their revenue by 6 times. But no, the things don't move at all. So this the problem of knowing everything, I know everything, is basically the problem. Here I was, where whether it is industry, whether it is sourcing, whether it is HR, whether it's finance, whether it is the management, whether it is administration, or whether it is how do you repair a filter, to how do you clean a toilet. I've been cleaning toilet of my company, and Shubhankar has been seeing that.
Yeah.
I have never asked anyone to do it. It's my company. It's my whom I have to know. And I would do that. So from there, we revived the company. And in that, Shubhankar is another, whatever you say, a very, very big mental burden for me. Because there's a commitment I've given.
Yeah.
So from there, not only did we revive, also there was a change. By the time my son had finished his master's from Imperial College, so he came back in one of those chuttis and he said that, why don't you also diversify? If you know so much, there is, because he had worked with me earlier in the company. He said, there is not one aspect of this company that you don't know. And more importantly, he says most of the things that I've been learning in Imperial College, he says, I've been seeing you practicing here from 6-7 years. And whatever new thoughts we had absolutely radical thoughts in our mind and we do it. He says, this is what is called design thinking, a word which did not exist sometime back. So it is all of this put together. So we put our entire might into consulting. That's where Shubhankar also, we both started off. I said, okay, let's do this one. And while we were doing consulting, while we would visit the companies and while we would carry out the entire audit and while we would do the thorough research on that company, sitting there, processes, and finally give the recommendations. And that is the time I started realizing that once I went to one company, the second was easier, the third even easier, the fourth even easier. Because the finally everything came down to here. As far as the thinking is concerned, all of them had only one common thing. We know everything. And that's the place where we started thinking, okay, no, this exactly is the problem. That if you know everything, then why the hell your company is not running right? The problem is that they only think, but no one has done these jobs on hand with their feet on ground themselves. So they assume funding, hire someone and he will do it. Hire someone, he'll do it. And you know, when we hired, what happened with us? It happens with everyone. I have seen 7 bankruptcies. So no one can actually tell me how exactly to run. I know why did I hit each. So today when we have completely turned around this company, we exactly know. And that's where this idea of the videos came, that if we have such deep experience, why don't we just share with everyone?
Yeah.
And that's where I come to the close of this particular episode, the 9th one.
Yes.
The next episode, I will talk about 2 cases in one episode and one more case in the next episode, half of it. And then gradually I'll hand it over to Shubhankar so that the changeover is very, very gradual. So we are going to be talking about a company where I did the entire work, the consulting part, including operationalizing the company. And thereafter, exactly what happened. And most of you will relate it to you or your friend or some other business that you already know. Because you know that what I talk is actually what I've got from ground. Thank you so much for listening. And Shubhankar with me says bye to you. And see you in the next episode. Episode number 10.
Episode number 10. See you guys.
Bye-bye.